Hi, everyone. This is Reverend Phil Dix. I happen to be the pastor of the Mingo and the Farrar United Methodist Churches, and I'm so excited to be here together with you today and to share a message with you. I just finished the worship service on Sunday morning. We were pleased to have Bishop Lori Haller, our bishop here in Iowa, to join us as part of the online worship, and as well, Hee-Chung Jeon, who is our district superintendent. And it was wonderful. We had so many people today. We had people from Oregon. We had people from the Outer Banks. We had people from Colorado. We just had people from everywhere, from León, Mexico. How wonderful it was to see just so many. And that's just part of it. It was great to be overflowing screen after screen of people that were joining us as part of our worship service together today. I want to thank them because we're going to continue to have our worship services. Today at the Mingo Church, we actually had our first soft opening, and we broadcast there, and they were able to see and be part of our worship, and even the folks that were online. So thank you all for doing that. But I wanted to answer that question for those of you who are asking if we're going to continue to do it. Yes, we will. Number two is, I got some wonderful news back from the charts of the analytics of looking at people who are contacting us and being part of our worship services on Sunday morning. We had over 1,000 people plus who were joining us on the average, and many of those, almost a third of those to a half of those, were new every week. So welcome. Now, I want to tell you what, we're trying to hold our services to 8 minutes because that's what they said the average contact was for us, was 8 minutes, so we're going to try to do that today as part of our message. So today what I want to do is talk with you a little bit, kind of a challenging word, because it's been a challenging week for us. Connie and I live just in back of the governor's mansion here in Iowa. And that was where the center of the protests were, part of them this week. And it was amazing to be part of that and to see that so close by. And yet to see at that particular gathering of protesters that it wasn't so much of a protest as it was an awakening for people that were there. So I want to talk to you today about, what would Jesus say to us in the midst of this, all protests and things that are going on in our world? Something, you know, is terribly wrong. You and I both know that. It's not right. It's not. So what do we do from this point forward? That's my question. What role can we play in healing our world and in serving Jesus as Jesus calls us to do? And now I have to hold a mirror up to myself and sometimes say, you know what? I think the problem really also is with me. Really. It's with me sometimes, because sometimes I have a real challenge in trying to really live out my faith and make it part of who I am in the world in which I find myself living on as part of that. So I'm reminded of a word that comes from Micah, the sixth chapter. It's what's called the Micah mandate. It was the prophet Micah who was asked by the people, what does God want of us? What does God require of us? And the whole Old Testament, it's so cool because he actually reveals it. God does and says, this is what I want you to do. Now, I want you to hear this. It's real simple. Three easy steps. Well, three challenging steps. It says this. What does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. Now, I want to be upfront and honest with you that those words sometimes are a little outside of our realm of thinking. Not that we're not smart people, it's just sometimes we don't hear many words about justice and mercy. And when we do, and humility, sometimes we just step back and go, I don't know if I'm into that. But I want to read the words for me from the paraphrase version of the Message Bible, because those words come to us in kind of every ordinary language. It says this, but God has already made it plain how to live and what to do. What God is looking for in men and women is quite simple. Now, hear the way they describe it. Rather than to act justly and to love mercy and walk humbly with God, they express it in this way. Do what is fair and just love your neighbor. Number one, do what's fair and love your neighbor, even those who persecute you. Number two, be compassionate and loyal in your love. Jesus demonstrated that throughout his ministry. That's what Jesus was all about. Whether they were for or against, or whether they were people that find themselves beleaguered, or whether they find themselves blind, or people who are demon-possessed, whether they were people that even didn't listen to what Jesus was saying, even sometimes his own disciples, he always called people to be compassionate to others and to be loyal in their love. And then he finally says this, I don't want you to take yourself too seriously, but take God seriously. So here's the question. This is all about social involvement, and yet on the other side of this is spirituality. Can social involvement and spirituality really come together? Or actually, is the real question, can it ever really be separated? We talk about justice without mercy, mercy without justice, or either without a spiritual humility, biblically is impossible. It's all woven together. Jesus said that. It's all about mercy and justice and being humble in our spirits. In other words, putting God first. You know, ever since the Garden of Eden, we've been bounced between those extremes, haven't we? About being just and being merciful and not. And the message of the prophet Micah is a powerful one for us as Christians today. To forge in our daily life God moments of decisions to speak up, to stand up and to love our neighbor and to make a bond between those inner principles and our outward conduct. Who we are and how we live. So what does the Lord require of us, you and me? To act justly, to show mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. To do what's fair and just to our neighbor, to be compassionate and loyal in your love, and don't take yourself too seriously. In the 1960s, eight boys came from inner city Chicago to Albia, Iowa. That's where I grew up. In the 1960s, it was an explosive time, similar to those the ways that it is today. I mean, it almost looks like the same. And in fact, I felt this weekend that I was looking back in those early 1960s, beyond the looting and screaming, to an intent to hurt our neighbor that deeply pains can really bring for them and ultimately for us a time of pain. I was a young boy of 10, and I heard the prejudices and I saw the pains inflicted on television, but it seemed so far away in another place in the South and not in my hometown. It seemed as if the world was completely different on the television. It was showing that world. I didn't want to be part of that. No one really did. In fact, we were horrified from it from a small town in Iowa. Everyone knew everyone. One of those idyllic communities where a community really loved and helped one another and helped the kids to grow up in those communities. And into that world, my world, came a young guy named Everett Bay, 10 years old, just like me. Everett was, again, one of those eight boys coming into our community from downtown Chicago. Can you imagine? And just as it was a culture shock for him, it was a culture shock for us. Everett was different. he was the same. He was 10. And we were friends, best buds, to the eight brave families who wanted to get those kids into the town of Albia. It was something more for their kids. My parents did it because of me. They wanted me to experience having a brother, having someone there to be with me, something that others would call different, but yet the same. I was excited. I was an only child. And even though being an only child has its benefits, it also has a downside. The downside became apparent when others talked about their brothers and sisters and playing together and doing those things. And I only had me. And deep down inside, I wanted a brother or a sister in my life. And now when you're 10 and you're going, and you hear you're going to have a brother or sister, you think of babies. But people would never expect to find a brother coming to them that was the same age of 10. I only knew that he was coming. My parents, they always called him Everett. So that's what I called him, Everett. And I was excited, a playmate, a kid like me. I remember preparing his room for him until my parents decided that maybe instead of sitting in a separate room, he needs to stay together with me. Are you serious? I thought. He gets to stay in a room with me. I remember putting up the bed and cleaning out my drawers so he could have half of them and putting his bed so it was angled right so he could see me and we could talk together each other each night. I was so proud. School wasn't on, but church was. We could go there. We could ride bikes together. And so we bought an extra bike, but not just one, for two. We both had a new bike. Same size, same shape, same color. Get the picture? I remember Everett arriving on the train from downtown Chicago into downtown Albia. A difference of maybe a million people, maybe. It was interesting as we did life together that summer of 61. And the difference between us, if someone would ask and say, do you notice there's a racial difference? I'm not sure what that means. All I know is I have straight hair and he has curly hair. That's the difference. But then there was that day when it all changed that summer. As you grow up, there are all kinds of people in your community. There's all kinds of good people. And there's also those who are challenging, that do challenging things, things that are not positive, and things that sometimes were not that good. Ever and I were riding bikes one day, and we stopped to figure out the way to go next. When you're great adventurers, you have to do that kind of thing. And when into the world came a few kids who were older and taller and meaner, and I can picture that moment even today. I can picture them using words and reflecting attitudes that I'd only seen on television. It was a painful moment. And when Everett and I tried to ride away, we were stopped. You know the story. You've probably had a time in your life when something like that happened to you. It's terrifying. When you hear and you see the hate and you speak it, for us, sometimes it's just once in a while. But for others, it's part of their daily life. It's what happened. They live in that world, and it taints them and generations, assuming oftentimes the worst in others rather than assuming the best that Jesus would sometimes ask us to do. I can recall standing face to face with them, with them before me. I'll never forget Everett. When they started speaking those taunting words, he put his face down, laid his bike down, and he walked away, and he just stood there with his head down and never spoke a word. I remember never seeing anything like that before. In silence, he just stood there looking down, and I thought to myself, even in later years, that's probably the culture he found himself in. And I was sad that he found that culture where we lived. It just wasn't what I thought we would find. And for a kid of 10, it was heartbreaking. And then came the moment when, in the midst of slurs and anger, focused on Everett and me, trying to stand up for Everett, came the ultimate slur. What is he, your brother? And I have to admit, the idea of Everett being my brother was something I'd hoped for, but I never really spoke out loud until that moment. And then face to face with evil and darkness and bigotry and hate and all that would mean, I just said it. Yes, he is my brother. I never looked to see what Everett did. Things just kept going until they finally walked away. Yes, Everett is my brother. And you know what? That made all the difference. To speak up for those who could not be heard. Speak up. Stand up and to love others as you love yourself. Summer 61. There were 1,000 stories my brother and I shared that summer, but best of all was when we spoke up, stood up, and loved one another as we loved others and ourselves. That's what I always shared with the confirmands in confirmation class. If you're a real Christian, be the persons who speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. You stand with people who are being bullied or picked on. The person who loves your neighbor as you love yourself, even if your neighbor is completely different than you, a different faith, a different background, a different colored skin, you're going to love your neighbor as you love yourself. That's what it means to be a Christian, to follow Christ, to love our neighbors and to speak up and stand with them. And that's my hope and prayer for you and for me and our world and our community, to stand up, to speak up, and to love them as you love yourself. Are we going to allow the Holy Spirit to give us courage? Are we going to allow the Spirit of God to guide us into truth? Are we going to redefine what truth is? Are we going to give into the ugly biases that sometimes we're raised with or that we see, or sometimes it's just convenient to mimic when we're in crowds of others with different opinions? Are you going to keep your heads down rather than speaking up? To be cowardly or to be courageous to speak up? Especially when we speak up for those who cannot speak up for themselves. There are many things that we can do to be champions of love, who encourage Christians, who stand with our neighbors and who are speaking up when they see something harmful or evil in the world and hurtful when something happens, and to demonstrate that love to all that we meet, to go be the church. Now I want to ask you to do something with that message today. I want you to ask you to do something with that verse today. I want to ask you to make a commitment today, to start somewhere, the smallest way, and to counter this do no harm, to show what do no harm means. John Wesley talked about do no harm in the terms of sin. He said there's a sins of commission and sins of omission. We don't hear much about the omission side. Sins of commission is be careful what you say. What you say can reflect upon our faith and can reflect upon you. But on the other side of what we say and what we do are the sins of omission, things we fail to do or fail to say. It's like when we're with someone and someone talks down about them and talks about gossip, rumor, and innuendo, what do we do? Sometimes we just remain silent. At least sometimes we agree with them and we enter into it. But at other times we just remain silent and we think to ourselves, see, I was gracious to do that. But sometimes God helping us and God with us and God guiding us, we plant a seed in that life. I want to ask you to do that this week, to try it out and to do what Jesus would do. I want to ask you to say to yourself and to Jesus,
First, I will not speak ill of other people. I will not speak ill of other people. It sounds easy, but sometimes it's the hardest thing. Because we put Christ first, what would Jesus have me do and to say? And to not practice gossiping or hearsay and to speak ill of others. And then to assume the very best in another person until we have no possibility of not doing that anymore. I will assume the best of people rather than the worst. I will speak up when other people are being harmed or threatened or picked on. I will stand with those who need me, and I will love my neighbor as I love myself. I hope you can make that commitment today so that we together can be a force for Christ, a force for good in pushing back, but pushing back the darkness of our world and bringing in some small way in the corner, bright in the corner where you are, His light, God's light. And love for all that we need. Let's pray together. Lord, you see these destructive acts and the crimes against one another, our brothers and sisters, because you know what? At times we are biased. Just like we're biased against you sometimes. We fail to see you and even follow you because we just don't think, oh God, that you really are strong enough, able enough, near enough. You see how easy it is, oh God, for us to be silent sometimes and make excuses for how hard it is to speak up, even when others hold a different view than ours. Lord, forgive us. Forgive us for what we hide in our hearts, for what we think about other people. Forgive us for the excuses that we make for the evil that we see in the world around us. Forgive us for our silence. We offer our lives to you. And now, oh God, we want to do something more. So I just invite you to hold out your hands, open up your palms, hold it right side up like a cup, and be ready for God's Spirit to fill us in these words. Repeat after me. Lord, I invite you to whisper this prayer right now. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Fill me with power. Fill me with courage. Fill me with love and fill me with a holy boldness. And use me, I pray, that our world might look different from and like your kingdom. Use me in Jesus' name. Amen. On the night when Jesus gathered together with his disciples, he took bread and broke it. And he offered it to his disciples, saying, "This bread is my body, which is broken for you and many for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and eat, and be thankful in your hearts." And likewise, when the supper had ended, Jesus took the cup, and having raised it to heaven, he blessed it. And he offered it to his disciples, saying, "This cup is my blood, poured out for you and many for the forgiveness of your sins." Liquid love. It's my promise to be with you yesterday and today and forever. To transform your life in the taking. What we eat, we become. And we partake of you, O God, and the promise, the gift that you showed us in loving us, not showing bias towards us, and accepting us even when we talked ill of you or just even forgot you. We remember you this day, and we are thankful. And when the supper had ended, Jesus said these words, "As often as you gather together, do this in remembrance of me." And for that, oh God, we give you thanks. Friends, I just want to invite you to just to go out into the world and see what's happening, what's going on with God in the world. Email me this week if, man, there's something going on or happening and you see God at work. If you had the opportunity really to stand up and to speak up and to love your neighbor, share that with me. I need to hear that. We need to hear it for each other. My email address is phildicks@gmail.com. Let me give it to you again. phildicks@gmail.com. Send me one of those emails so I have a chance to worship with you, pray, and pray for you if that's what you need. I'd love to be part of that. Let me remind you that each week on our websites, we do post the codes and the links for our worship services. We have our worship service at 9 o'clock and also at 11 o'clock.
on Sunday mornings. And we also have an evening Vesper service on Tuesday. And we also have a Wednesday morning coffee time. And you can join us for any of those. But if you go to www.farrarumc.org or Mingo, www.mingoumc.org, you'll find the links. Or check us out on Facebook. We post those there every week. My prayer is, friends, that you'll be able to go with us and be with us as part of that, to join the community as we do life together. That's what it's all about. Love each other, forgive one another, and just realize that God is present. Friends, this is going to be a challenging week for us ahead. Trust me, I know that will be. It's a challenging day before us, but it's a new day. We can put it together. And you know what? You're not alone in this, and God is with us. That's the promise. And when God is with us and together, we work on our relationship together and we fall in love even in the smallest ways. And then we look and see where God is at work and we look for the God wink moments. And when we see them, we acknowledge them and we claim it and call it a God moment. And the scripture says when we acknowledge where we see God at work in our life, God has this amazing tendency, like a loving Heavenly Father, to suddenly do what? To send more God moments into our life, and in greater frequency and in greater depth. That's the promise. Live in that promise this week. You are not alone. We're praying for you. And we want you to know that we invite you to be part of changing the world, ambassadors for Christ. And as we say in our church, to learn what it means to live it out by go be the church. What does that mean? Get out of here. Go. Go make a difference in the world. This is not where it goes. It's not staying in church. It's going out into the world. John Wesley, the world is our parish. That's what it's about. Go out and find those in need. Pray for those who you find at the checkout stand as you go through Walmart, wherever it may be. The people who look like they need God, pray for them. Or just give them a word. Plant a seed of love in their lives. To talk good about them and offer them a word of life. I've done it. And I've watched people change because it's been a long time since anyone's spoken that word and had someone care and love for them. So go from this place, we pray. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And all the people said, amen. That means I agree. Friends, go be the church. Get out of here. See you again next week. Blessings. God go with you.